that everything was dead with the coming of Dean Moriarty began the part of my life you could call my life on the road. Before that, I'd often dreamed of going west to see the country, always vaguely planning and never taking off. Dean is the perfect guy for the road because he actually was born on the road when his parents were passing through Salt Lake City in 1926 in a jalopy on their way to Los Angeles. First reports of him came to me through Chad King, who'd shown me a few letters from him written in a New Mexico reform school. I was tremendously interested in the letters because they so naively and sweetly asked Chad to teach him all about Nietzsche and all the wonderful intellectual things that Chad knew. At one point, Carlo and I talked about the letters and wondered if we would ever meet the strange Dean Moriarty. This is all far back when Dean was not the way he is today, when he was a young jail kid shrouded in mystery. Then news came that Dean was out of reform school and was coming to New York for the first time. Also, there was talk that he had just married a girl called Mary Lou. One day, I was hanging around the campus, and Chad and Tim Gray told me that Dean was staying in a cold water pad in East Harlem, the Spanish Harlem. Dean had arrived the night before, the first time in New York with his beautiful little sharp chick Mary Lou. They got off of the Greyhound bus at 50th Street and cut around the corner looking for a place to eat and went right in Hector's. And since then, Hector's cafeteria has always been a big symbol of New York for Dean. They spent money on beautiful big glazed cakes and cream puffs. All this time, Dean was telling Mary Lou things like this: "Now, darling, here we are in New York, and although I haven't quite told you everything that I was thinking about when we crossed Missouri, and especially at the point when we passed the Boonville Reformatory, which reminded me of my jail problem, it is absolutely necessary now to postpone all those leftover things concerning our personal love things, and at once begin thinking of specific work-life plans." And so on, in the way that he had in those earlier days. I went to the Coldwater flat with the boys, and Dean came to the door in his shorts. Mary Lou was jumping off the couch. Dean had dispatched the occupant of the apartment to the kitchen, probably to make coffee, while he proceeded with his love problems. For to him, sex was the one and only holy and important thing in life, although he had sweat and cursed to make a living, and so on. You saw that in the way he stood, bobbing his head, always looking down, nodding, like a young boxer to instructions, to make you think he was listening to every word, throwing in 1,000 yeses and that's rights. My first impression of Dean was of a young Gene Autry, trim, thin-hipped, blue-eyed, with a real Oklahoma accent, a sideburned hero of the snowy West. In fact, he'd just been working on a ranch at Walls in Colorado before marrying Mary Lou and coming east. sat in the living room reading her newspaper. She took one look at Dean and decided that he was a madman. In the bar, I told Dean, "Hell, man, I know very well you didn't come to me only to want to become a writer, and after all, what do I really know about it except you've got to stick to it with the energy of a penny addict?" And he said, "Yes, of course, I know exactly what you mean, and in fact, all those problems have occurred to me, but the thing that I want is the realization of those factors that should one depend on Schopenhauer's dichotomy for any inwardly realized, and so on. In that way, things I understood, not a bit, and he himself didn't. In those days, he really didn't know what he was talking about. That is to say, he was a young jail kid all hung up on the wonderful possibilities of becoming a real intellectual. The situation was too Benzedrine hallucination with her baby girl in her arms and ending up in Bellevue. And Dean told Carlo of unknown people in the West like Tommy Snark, the club-footed pool hall rotation shark and card player and queer saint. He told him of Roy Johnson, Big Ed Dunkel, his boyfriend buddies, his street buddies, his innumerable girls and sex parties and pornographic pictures, his heroes, heroines, adventures. They rushed down the street together, digging everything in the early way they had, which later became so much sadder and perceptive and blank. But then they danced down the streets like dingle toadies, and I shambled after, as I've been doing all my life, after people who interest me, because the only people for me are the mad ones, the ones who are mad to live, mad to talk, mad to be saved, desirous of everything at the same time, the ones who never yawn or say a commonplace thing.
Working like that.
his suffering bony face and the long sideburns and his straining muscular sweating neck made me remember my boyhood in those dye dumps and swim holes and riversides of Patterson and the Passaic. His dirty work clothes clung to him so gracefully as though San Francisco. Cimarron, and so on. And on the roadmap was one long red line called Route 6 that led from the tip of Cape Cod clear to Ely, Nevada, and their dip down to Los Angeles. I'll just stay on 6 all the way to Ely, I said to myself. Trapped was an ordinary bus trip, with crying babies and hot sun, and country folk getting on at one pin down after another, till we got on the plain of Ohio, and really rolled up to Ashtabula, and straight across Indiana in the night. I arrived in Chi quite early in the morning, got a room in the Y, and went to bed with a very few dollars in my pocket. I ducked Chicago after a good day's sleep. The wind from Lake Michigan, pop at the lip, long walks around South Halstead and North Clark, and one long walk after midnight into the jungles, where a cruising car followed me as a suspicious character. At this time, 1947, Bob was going like mad all over America. The fellows at the Loop blew, and with a tired air, because Bob was somewhere between its Charlie Parker ornithology period and another period that began with Miles Davis. And as I sat there listening to that sound of the night which Bob has come to represent for all of us, I thought of all my friends from one end of the country to the other, and how they were really all in the same vast backyard, doing something so frantic and rushing about. And for the first time in my life, the following afternoon, I went into the West. It was a warm and beautiful day for hitchhiking. To get out of the impossible complexities of Chicago traffic, I took a bus to Joliet, Illinois, went by the Joliet Penn, stationed myself just outside town. After a walk through its leafy, rickety streets behind, and pointed my way all the way from New York to Joliet by bus, and I had spent more than half my money. My first ride was a dynamite truck with a red flag about 30 miles into Great Green, Illinois. The truck driver pointed out the place where Route 6, which we were on, intersects Route 66. Before they both shoot west for incredible distances, along about 3 in the afternoon, after an apple pie and ice cream in a roadside stand, a woman stopped for me in a couple in a little coupe. Along about 3 in the afternoon, after an apple pie and ice cream in a roadside stand, a woman stopped for me in a little coupe. I had a twinge of heart joy as I ran after the car, but she was a middle-aged woman, actually the mother of sons my age, and wanted somebody to help her drive to Iowa. I was all for it. Iowa, not so far from Denver, and once I got to Denver, I could relax. She drove the first few hours, at one point insisting on visiting an old church somewhere, as if we were tourists, and then I took over the wheel and thought, I'm not much of a driver, drove clear through the rest of Illinois to Davenport, Iowa, via Rock Island, and here, for the first time in my life, I saw my beloved Mississippi River, dry in the summer haze, low water, with its big, rank smell that smells like the raw body of America itself, because it washes it up. Rock Island, railroad trucks, shacks, small downtown section, and over the bridge to Davenport. Same kind of town, all smelling of sawdust in the warm Midwest sun. anxious, of course, I decided to gamble. I took a bus in downtown Davenport after spending a half hour watching a waitress in the bus station cafe and rode to the city limits. But this time, near the gas stations, here the big trucks roared. Wham! And inside 2 minutes, one of them cranked to a stop for me. I ran forward with my soul whooping. And what a driver. A great big tough truck driver with popping eyes and a hoarse, raspy voice who just slammed and kicked at everything and got his rig underway and paid hardly any attention to me. So I could rest my tired soul a little, for one of the biggest troubles hitchhiking is having to talk to innumerable people, make them feel that they didn't make a mistake picking you up, even entertain them almost, all of which is a great strain when you're going all the way and don't plan to sleep in hotels. The guy just yelled above the roar, and all I had to do was yell back. Just as we rolled into Iowa City, he saw another truck coming behind us, and because he had to turn off at Iowa City, he blinked his taillights at the other guy and slowed down for me to jump out, which I did with my bag, and the other truck, acknowledging this exchange, stopped for me, and once again, in the twink of nothing, I was in another big high cab, all set hundreds of miles across the night, and was I happy. And the new truck driver was as crazy as the other and yelled just as much, and all I had to do was lean back and roll on. Now I could see Denver looming ahead of me like the promised land. Way out there beneath the stars, across the prairie of Iowa and the plains of Nebraska, and I could see the greater vision of San Francisco beyond, like jewels in the night. He pulled the jack and told stories for a couple of hours. Then, at a town in Iowa, where years later Dean and I were stopped station, I made the acquaintance of another hitchhiker, a typical New Yorker, an Irishman who'd been driving a truck for the post office most of his work years and was now headed for a girl in Denver and a new life. I think he was running away from something in New York, the law most likely. He was a real red-nosed young drunk of 30 and would have bored me ordinarily except that my senses were sharp for any kind of human friendship. He wore a beet sweater and baggy pants and had nothing with him in the way of a bag, just a toothbrush and handkerchief. He said we ought to hitch together. I should have said no, because he looked pretty awful on the road, but we stuck together and got a ride with the taciturn man to Stewart, Iowa, a town in which we were really stranded. We stood in front of the railroad ticket shack in Stewart, waiting for the westbound traffic till the sun went down, a good 5 hours, dawdling away the time, at first telling about ourselves, then he told dirty stories, then we just kicked pebbles and made goofy noises of one kind and another. We got bored. I decided to spend a buck on beer. Saloon in Stewart and had a few. There, he got as drunk as he ever did in his 9th Avenue night back home and yelled joyously in my ear all the sordid dreams of his life. I kind of liked him, not because he was a good sort, as he later proved to be, but because he was enthusiastic about things. We got back on the road in the darkness, and of course nobody stopped, and nobody came by much. That went on till 3 o'clock in the morning. We spent some time trying to sleep on the beach at the railroad ticket office, but the telegraph clicked all night, and we couldn't sleep, and big freights were slamming around outside. We didn't know how to hop a proper chain. We arrived at Council Bluffs at dawn. I looked out. All winter, I'd been reading of the great wagon parties that held council there before hitting the Oregon and Santa Fe trails, and of course, now it was only cute suburban cottages of one damn kind and another, all laid out. Small gray dawn, then Omaha, staff, Callan Kett, called us over and wanted to know if either one of us could drive. Of course, Eddie could drive, and he had a license, and I didn't. Cowboy had two cars with him that he was driving back to Montana. His wife was at Grand Island, and he wanted us to drive one of the cars there, where she'd take over. At that point, he was going north, and that would be the limit of our ride with him. But it was a good 100 miles into Nebraska, and of course, we jumped for it. Eddie drove alone, the cowboy and myself following, and no sooner were we out of town than Eddie started to pull that jack 90 miles an hour out of his sheer exuberance. "Damn me, what's that boy doing?" the cowboy shouted and took off after him. It began to be like a race. For a minute, I thought Eddie was trying to get away with the car, and for all I know, that's what he meant to do. But the cowboy stuck to him and caught up with him and tooted the horn. Eddie slowed down. The cowboy tooted to stop. "Damn, boy, you're liable to get a fight going that speed. Can't you drive a little slower?" "Well, I'll be damned, was I really going 90? Said Eddie. "I didn't realize it on this smooth road. Just take it a little easy and we'll all get to Grand Island in one piece." "Sure thing." And we resumed our journey. Eddie had calmed down and probably even got sleepy. So we drove 100 miles across Nebraska, following the Windling Platte with its verdant fields. "During the Depression," said the cowboy to me, "I used to hop freights at least once a month. In those days, you'd see hundreds of men riding a flat car or in a box car, and they weren't just bums. They were all kinds of men, out of work and going from one place to another, and some of them just wandering. It was like that all over the West." "Brakemen never bothered you in those days?" "I don't know about today, Nebraska. I ain't got no use for. Why, in the middle 1930s, this place wasn't nothing but a big dust cloud as far as the eye could see. You couldn't breathe. The ground was black. I was here in those days. They can give Nebraska back to the Indians, far as I'm concerned. I hate this damn place more than any place in the world. Montana's my home now. Missoula. You come up there sometime and see God country." Later in the afternoon, I slept when he got tired talking. He was an interesting talker. We stopped along the road for a bite to eat. The cowboy went off to have a spare tire patched, and Eddie and I sat down in a kind of homemade dinner. I heard a great laugh, the greatest laugh in the world, and here came this rawhide old-timer, Nebraska farmer, with a bunch of other boys into the diner. You could hear his raspy cries clear across the plains, across the whole great world of them that day. Everybody else laughed with him. He didn't have a care in the world and had the hugest regard for everybody. I said to myself, "Wham, listen to that man laugh. That's the West. Here I am in the West." He came booming into the diner, calling Ma's name, and she made the sweet across to Shelton. Here, Eddie stood, forlornly, in the road in front of a staring bunch of short, squat Omaha Indians who had nowhere to go and nothing to do. Across the road was the railroad track with the water tank saying, "Shelton." "Damn me," said Eddie with amazement. "I've been in this town before. It was years ago, during the war, at night, late at night, when everybody was sleeping. I went out on the platform to smoke. Shelton written on the water tank. Bound for the Pacific. Everybody snoring. Every damn dumb sucker. And we only stayed a few minutes stoking up or something. And off we went. Damn me, this Shelton. I hated this place ever since. And we were stuck in Shelton. As in Davenport, Iowa. Somehow. All the cars were farmer cars, and once in a while, a tourist car, which is worse, with old men driving and their wives pointing out the sights or poring over maps and sitting back looking at everything with suspicious faces. The drizzle increased, and Eddie got cold. He had very little clothing. I fished a bag, and he put it on. He felt a little better. I had a cold. I bought cough drops in a rickety Indian store of some kind. I went to the little 2x4 post office and wrote my aunt a penny postcard. We went back to the gray road. There she was in front of us. Shelton written on the water tank. The Rock Island saw the faces of Pullman passengers go by in a blur. The train howled off across the plains in the direction of our desires. It started to rain harder. A tall, lanky fellow in a gallon hat stopped his car on the wrong side of the road and came over to us. He looked like a sheriff. We prepared our stories secretly. He took his time coming over. "You boys going to get somewhere or just going?" We didn't understand his question, and it was a damn good question. "Why?" we said. "Well, I own a little carnival that's pitched a few miles down the road, and I'm looking for some old boys willing to work and make a buck for themselves. I've got a roulette concession and a wooden ring concession. You know, the kind you throw around dolls and take your luck. You boys want to work for me, you can get 30% of the take. Room and board. You can get a bed, but no food. You'll have to eat in town. We travel some." We thought it over. "It's a good opportunity," he said, and waited patiently for us to make up our minds. We felt silly and didn't know what to say, and I, for one, didn't want to get hung up with a carnival. I was in such a bloody hurry to get to the gang in Denver. I said, "I don't know. I'm going as fast as I can, and I don't think I have the time." Eddie said the same thing, and the old man waved his hand and casually sauntered back to his car and drove off. And that was that. We laughed about it a while, and kissed the shirt goodbye. It had only sentimental value in any case. I waited in our personal god-awful shelter for a long, long time. Several hours. And I kept thinking it was getting night. Actually, it was only early afternoon. But dark. Start.